and welcome to the Alliance Church. What a beautiful day we have. Stand with us, please, and singing, "This is the day that the Lord has made."
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made.
Okay, now sing it with a little more enthusiasm.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made. I'm so glad that our Father in heaven tells of his love in the book he has given. Wonderful things in the Bible I see. This is the dearest that Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves even me. Though I forget him and wander away, still he does love me wherever I stray. Back to his dear loving arms would I flee. When I remember that Jesus loves me, I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves even me. Oh, if there's only one song I can sing, if in his beauty I see the great King, this shall my song through eternity be. Oh, what a wonder that Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves even me.
Okay, now we're going to change that chorus a little bit. This time we're going to sing, "I am so glad that Jesus loves you." We're going to point to all these people and your brothers and sisters in here, right?
I am so glad that Jesus loves you, and Jesus loves you, and Jesus loves you. Oh, I am so glad that Jesus loves you, and Jesus loves even you.
Come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him.
We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him.
Worship him, Jesus Christ the Lord.
Let's forget about ourselves and magnify his name and worship him. Let's forget about ourselves and magnify his name and worship him. Let's forget about ourselves and magnify his name and worship Christ the Lord. Worship him, Christ the Lord.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this glorious day. Thank you for each one that's come to worship you and be in your house today. Be with the ones who can't make it today. Watch over Jeremiah. He's not feeling well. Watch over the children that watch that were here in our Sunday school class. Bless you. Bless us with more children, Lord, that are the kingdom of heaven. Be with the people that are traveling today, and be with our leaders, Lord. Guide them to make the right decisions, and we'll ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Yay!
Okay. Whoa, hand crap. Everybody, what do you call a handshake?
Holy hands.
Everybody, good morning.
Holy hands.
Good morning, good morning.
I have an announcement, too.
Okay. Okay. If I forget something, hello?
It's like turning your microphone on.
It's on. It's on. At least the red light's on. That doesn't mean.
Here it is.
Oh, here I am. Got to do my usual. Luke, I'm your grandfather. My oldest grandson is named Luke. And every time I see him.
Dark Vader.
Yeah. Dark Vader, yeah. Okay. People, I know somebody's in here. Where are you? I saw you. Somebody's here for the first time. Stand up and be recognized.
You're back for the first time?
Back for the first time this year. Or new, first time ever. Come on up.
Stand up.
Stand up. Yeah, you got to. You got
to. There
we
go.
Over there. Good. Good to have you back. Your name is? Where'd you spend?
I was in Washington State at my son's for 4 months. Get out of the heat. And then it was really hot there, too.
Yeah, it was.
Welcome home.
The frying pan thing. Yeah. Okay. Good. Good to have you back. Okay. We got that out of the way. Birthday.
Right there.
Stand up.
Get up.
I'm going to have my son out. I'm
sorry. Oh,
and another. And another. No, wait a minute.
Happy birthday to you.
That's pretty good. Jeremiah only gets one or so. I got three. Yeah.
Yeah. Yay.
Okay. The blessing. I'm not real good with blessings, but we used to say a thing in the church I used to go to. Many happy returns to the day of thy birth. May sunshine and gladness be given. And may our dear Father prepare you on earth for a beautiful birthday in heaven.
Oh, yeah.
That's where you're headed. God bless you. That it?
Anniversary.
Anniversaries.
Anniversaries.
You have to speak up. I'm deaf in this ear and I can't hear in the other one. Birthdays?
Anniversaries.
Anniversaries.
Nope. Okay.
Well, we're Jeremiah and I are even with that one. Okay. So we'll have Jim come up and do the announcements. Oh, wait, I'm already here. I'm going to have a good time at this, whether you like it or not. Okay. Now, this is last week's, 9:26, but they're all the same. Tuesday, TOPS meets at 7 a.m. in the fellowship hall over there. Thursday, quilting 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. in the fellowship hall again. How many you have last week?
About 10.
10 again. Wow. Friday, teen rec night, 6 p.m. Saturday, fellowship breakfast at the eatery. We had a good crowd this last Saturday. Yesterday. Okay. That's that. Now again, I'm going to sit down before I fall down. You're all familiar with my... Like I tell people, I don't mind suffering in silence as long as everybody knows I'm suffering. Okay? Well, on the back of your bulletin, we have this list. It's a pretty good size list. There's people on here. You know, pray for them. And I'm not going to pray for all. Read these, and we'll just ask the Lord to bless this time today. Pastor's not here. We'll pray for him. And anybody else have somebody? Lucy, is coming back real soon. She's well. We had a few pass away. Bill Hott, I think that's the way you pronounce his name. Ed Judd, Dwayne Wilson, Marcia's brother-in-law, they have gone on to glory, on to heaven. So, but there's still a lot of these here that need our prayers. So let's go to prayer right now. And yes.
Knee surgery.
Okay. Let's just pray right now. Father in heaven, we do thank you for your love. We thank you for your mighty, mighty love. Lord, what a great God and Savior you are. You know our hurts, our needs. And Father, we know that you already have us on your list and that you are already working with us. Father, we pray that you would continue that. Heal as you see fit, Father. For Linda going in for surgery, Lord, we just pray that you would give the doctor skill and understanding and give her a quick heal and a quick recovery. And we ask that in Jesus' name. And Father, for Jeremiah, Pastor Jeremiah and his sickness, get him well, Father. Restore him to good health and just bless him mightily in that manner. Father, thank you for all these people, these beautiful people that are here this morning. I ask that you would bless them and be with them in every way. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Ken has something you want to say.
Don't forget that next Sunday is Pastor Appreciation Day. We'll get hot lunch after the service at 1 o'clock. We're going to have cake and ice cream along with the pasta. And I was going to love you to three cards. One for Jeremiah and one for Rob.
Okay, and I have an announcement. We are going to be having a women's group. It's praying for the Quartzsite kids. It's this coming Wednesday from 6 to 7. Please arrive early. We're going to be studying God's attributes, intercede for the youth, see God's prayers answered. It's going to be at my house. The phone number is on the bottom. I live real close here, so it's pretty easy to find. But it's going to start this Wednesday from 6 to 7.
Okay.
Nancy, don't forget Nancy. Don't forget your wife.
Oh.
You know there's always me.
Did you tell me this time?
No, I didn't this time.
Oh.
So I'm just reminding everybody, in case you weren't here last week, about the kids' dinner this week. It's actually next Saturday. It's the ninth. Some of our kids, as I explained, are going through this training program, so they're going to cook and serve and bus and do dishes and everything. And this is just an introductory to them to go out and learn how to do customer service and get their job. So the tickets you can get are $12.50 per person at Karen's Cafe. They're limited. I honestly don't know how many they have left now. Karen's opens Tuesday for breakfast, or if you want to come to the ladies' luncheon, you can get your tickets there. But they're limiting how many dinners, and so hopefully if you haven't got your tickets, get them and come and help these kids learn how to be productive, contributing citizens to our society. Yay. Good. The dinner will be at 5 o'clock at Karen's on Saturday the 9th. Thanks.
Okay. Do we do communion now or should we do it later? You want to do it now? Am I in charge?
Let's eat.
Let's do. I didn't prepare for this very much, so can we have the ushers forward, four of you? I think I can do it. Yep. Oh, yeah, I'm supposed to say something. We all know that this is not the body of Christ. This is bread, flour, and oil. But it is symbolic of the body of the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself, his life, for each and every one of us there on Calvary. And Father, we just need to remember the great and wonderful sacrifice that he has made for each and every one of us. What a mighty God we serve. And he passed it out to each of his disciples. And he said, here, take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do it always in remembrance of me. Let's take the bread. And having taken the bread, he took the cup and he passed it out to all his disciples.
Lay aside the garments that you've been moving. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? Soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? When the bridegroom comes, will your robes be white? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for his presence to bright and be washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
When Jesus took the cup, he passed it around to all his disciples, and they all took a sip. Some days ago, I mentioned the marriage ceremony in Galilee, the thing where the bridegroom offered the wine to his betrothed. She sipped, which meant that she would marry him, that she would be with him. And he did not drink it. Jesus did not drink it at that time. with his disciples. He said, I will not take of this cup until I drink of it in my Father's house. That's in the future. That's coming soon, folks. Be ready. Be knowing who Jesus Christ is. Be committed to him. And having said that, they all took the cup. I admire Jeremiah when he stands up here. He's got a lot of presence about him. Walks back and forth, puts his hand in his pocket. I am amazed that this paper's not shaking. This is a very heavy, not heavy. He makes everything light. It's important, very important, that we do this and worship our Lord. Okay. Welcome. You know, it wasn't too long ago we didn't have any babies in our church. Now look at them. Come on in. Okay, I'm gonna cover a few things today. I hope it's interesting to you. It was exciting to me when I first found out about it. It has to do with a man named Zelophehad. Anybody ever heard of him? One, two. Okay. Very important that we know. Good for you, Cookie. Okay, good. But before I get started in him, I'm going to give you a little history on the kings of Israel. Excuse me, Judah, and the kings of Judah. This was at the close of the age of the area of the era of the kings. There was a king there. He was quite evil, Manasseh. He had a son named Josiah. Okay, and Josiah was a good king. He did everything right in the eyes of the Lord, and consequently, the Lord gave him a span of 40 years that he ruled Israel, but he eventually died. And his son that took over, Jehoahaz, I don't think he even lasted a few months, 3 months or something like that. He did evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord took him out right away. The next king, Jehoiakim, he didn't last very long either. And then in the days of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, this happened in 606 B.C., Jehoiakim became his vassal for 3 years. This was I don't know if you know it or not, but the invasion of Israel, remember? They took all the captives and took them to Babylon. That was in 606 B.C. Nebuchadnezzar came against Israel. He didn't tear up a whole lot of things. He killed a lot of people in that siege and in that conquering that city. But he took those captives. Then he put another man in charge, another king, named Jehoiachin. His name was also Coniah. This guy, Jehoiakim, wasn't really good either. He was did not do good in the eyes of the Lord. And Jehoiachin did even worse. He was quite evil. He was 18 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 3 months. Then Jehoiachin, king of Judah, his mother's servants, princes, and his officers went out to the king of Babylon, and the king of Babylon, in the eighth year of his reign, took him prisoner and carried him to Babylon captive. Okay. Jehoiachin was 8 years old when he became king and reigned in Jerusalem 3 months and 10 days, and he did evil. This Jehoiachin was exceptionally evil, and In Jeremiah chapter 22, verse 28 and 29, there's a scripture verse in there, two verses. 28 says, is this man, Coniah, a despised, broken idol? This is the man who was king toward the end. A broken idol, a vessel in which is no pleasure. Why are they cast out, and he and his descendants, and cast into a land which you do not know? O earth, 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 hear the word of the Lord. And then he goes on and says, He is a man who shall not prosper in his days, for none of his descendants shall prosper and rule any more in Judah. So the line of David, from David all the way down to this last king, Jehoiachin, that was where the genealogy of the Lord Jesus Christ, the genealogy traveled. But it stopped there. It's been called the scarlet thread of redemption did not end there. It continued on through the Lord Jesus Christ. But the age of the kings was over with him. And he wrote, God said to write him, in the King James, it says to write him childless. No more kings would sit on the throne of David, which implied that on down that genealogical line, it was from David through Solomon, on down that line was a man called Jacob. His son was named Joseph. We know who Joseph was. He was betrothed to Mary. If that line was true, was Joseph Jesus' father? No, he wasn't. He was his stepfather. Who was Jesus' father? God. Got that out real quick. I've got a thing over here. I'm gonna do it in this time. Okay. Anyway, there would be no kings along that line. I have trouble with staying in line. Anyway, Numbers, if we go to Numbers chapter 27, verse 1 through 11, we talk about the man called Zelophehad. I'm going to read here. I'm going to actually do quite a bit of reading. Then came the daughters of Zelophehad, the son of Hepher, son of Gilead, the son of Machir, and the son of Manasseh, from the families of Manasseh, the son of Joseph. And these were the Joseph that was in Egypt. Okay. And these were the names of his daughters, Mela, Nola, Hogla, Milcah, Tirgra. And they stood before Moses, before Eleazar the priest, and before the leaders and all the congregation by the doorway of the tabernacle of the meeting, saying, "Our father died in the wilderness, but he was not in the company of those who gathered together against the Lord, in company with Korah, but he died in his own sin, and he had no sons. Why should the name of our father be removed from among his family because he had no son? Give us a possession among our father's brothers." In Israel in those days, in Judah, only men, only the firstborn, secondborn, thirdborn, only men could inherit the land. Women could not. And these daughters said, "Well, that's not fair." Everybody else said that? Of course it did. That we deserve a inheritance in the land in order to keep our father's name going. So Moses said to them, he said, "We'll go check it out with the Lord." He and Aaron went to the Lord, and the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "The daughters of Zelophehad speak what is right. You shall surely give them a possession of inheritance among their father's brothers, and cause the inheritance of their father to pass to them. And you shall speak to the children of Israel, saying, If a man dies and has no son, then you shall cause his inheritance to pass to his daughter. If he has no daughter, then the inheritance will go to the first of nearest kinsman redeemer, nearest kinsman. So God is saying, okay, you're right, you will get an inheritance. There was some stipulations made to that. In Numbers 36, chapter 36, it says in verse 2, The Lord commanded my Lord Moses to give the land as an inheritance to the children of Israel, and my Lord was commanded by the Lord. In other words, my Lord Moses was commanded by the Lord to give an inheritance to our brother Zelophehad to his daughters. Now, if they are married to any of the sons of other tribes, the children of Israel, then their inheritance will be taken from the inheritance of our fathers, and it will be added to the inheritance of the tribe into which they marry. So it will be taken from the lot of our inheritance. They don't want them. The daughter can only inherit if she marries, and then the son and her inherit the land. If she marries outside the tribe, then at the Jubilee, the land will go to the other tribe, and it will be confusion. So they came up with another solution to that. Moses commanded children according to the word of the Lord, said, What the tribe of Joseph, of the sons of Joseph, speaks is right. This is what the Lord commands concerning the daughters of Zelophehad, saying, Let them marry who they think best, but they may marry only within the family of their father's tribe. So the inheritance of the children of Israel will not change hands from tribe to tribe, for every one of the children of Israel to keep the inheritance of his father. Okay, this was all granted by Joseph. When Joshua moved the Israelites up to the Jordan River, he read this sermon of Moses. He read it again. The Lord commanded Moses to give us an inheritance among our brothers. Therefore, according to the commandment of the Lord, he gave them an inheritance among their father's brothers. In other words, we're talking about the daughters here again. 10 shares fell to Manasseh on the land of Gilead and Bashan, which were on the other side of Jordan, because the daughters of Manasseh received an inheritance among his. Okay. Way it worked was the young girl would marry. In order for her and he to inherit the land, her father had to adopt her husband. So now he was not only his son-in-law, he was his son, which had every right of a firstborn son. So that's how they inherited the land. That's how the name of Zelophehad continued on. If I had that name, I think I would change it. Because I don't even think I'm saying it right. Every detail, all of this anticipates the lineage of Christ. I love that term, that scarlet thread of redemption, which traveled all the way from Genesis 3:15, the promise that God made to Adam, the seed of the woman will crush the head of the serpent. The seed of the serpent will bruise his heel. It was a direct reference to the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus Christ, the defeat of Satan on the cross by our Lord. Every detail, even in the regulations of the Torah, are there by deliberate design and always point to Christ. I made the point several times in the Sunday school. Everything in the Old Testament points to the cross. Everything in the New Testament points back to the cross. They have changed. Remember what BC means?
Before Christ.
What does AD mean? No. It means in... No, that's not what it means. It means in the year of our Lord. In the year... Annum Deum. Annum Deum. In the year of our Lord. And that's what... That was on the... I think first time it was seen was in the Mayflower Compact, in the year of our Lord, whatever it was.
Adam what?
Annum, A-N-U-M, D-E-I-M. Annum meaning year, Deum meaning God, in the year of our Lord. Okay, here's a little quick history of Zelophehad. He's a personal... His personal name meaning is protection from terror, or the kinsman is my protector. This term kinsman in the scriptures is very important. You should do a little word study on that. Zelophehad was a Hebrew who wandered in the wilderness with Moses. He had no sons to receive his property and carry on his name. So his daughters pled with Moses to receive a share of inheritance following his death. Okay, he wandered with Moses. Remember when they came out of Egypt? They were 2 years at Mount Sinai. Moses got the law, brought it down. They were actually training, organizing, becoming an army, a mighty army. Just out of curiosity, how many people you think crossed the Red Sea? They numbered the warriors, the men 20 to 50, there at Sinai. 600,000, 606,000, I think. That was just the men. 606,000. They were married, 20 to 50. They were married. So there's 1.2 million. Did they have, if you go with today's standards, I think the average children is 1.7. Have you ever seen the 0.7 kids running around? 2 is common. So that's another 2.4 million. So it's possibly 3 to 5, 6 million people. Have you ever considered Phoenix moving west? the whole city of Phoenix, and that's only 4 million coming and marching. That was a major process in an organization, and it took God to do that. But anyway, they strengthened themselves, and at the right time they moved in order up to Kadesh Barnea, which is the gateway to the southern entrance to Canaan, and that's where they were going in. And that's where God said, just go in and occupy. He didn't say anything about drawing it. Well, he did too. He said, you won't have to draw a sword. You won't have to shoot an arrow or throw a rock. I will drive them out from before you with hornets. But what did they do? They sent the spies in. They came back. We can't do it. They're too big for us. They did not believe God. What is the simplest definition of sin? Unbelief. Whatever God has said, reject. They reject it. That is unbelief. Okay. So that consequently they went back down and wandered in the wilderness for another 38 years. It took 2 years of training and all that at Sinai and getting the law and then moving up. And then they wandered another 38 years. 40 years they wandered. They paid for that. They got back to around with Joshua to the Jordan. They were getting ready to go across and take Jericho. And Joshua read the law again, and this was re-emphasized that the daughters of that Zelophehad were to receive an inheritance. Not only they, but any other man who had a daughter and no sons, it also applied to them. That was in the Levitical laws. God put it in there for that purpose. God has a lot of laws. Our nation's laws, what are they modeled after? The Bible. A lot of the laws in our nation today are modeled right after the Bible, right after Scripture. So So who's smarter, our government or God? Don't answer that. Okay. Now I want to go to back to Matthew. There's two genealogies. One is in Matthew and one is in Luke. There's actually three genealogies in the New Testament. One Matthew, one Luke. Where's the other one? John. First three verses. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things are created by Him. So, yeah, three genealogies. But in Matthew, the book of genealogy, Jesus Christ, the Son of David, starts with Abraham. Why Abraham? Because, huh?
First Jew.
Well, Abraham wasn't a Jew. the nation of Israel came out of him, but he was not. That's why. What caused Abraham to be righteous? He believed God. Simple little child. That's what she's saying right there. I understand her. So simple that a child can understand it, but so difficult for a grown person to understand and accept. That doesn't make sense. Okay. But this starts with Abraham because Matthew, each one of the four Gospels has a theme to it. Matthew shows Jesus as king. So when did the nation of Israel begin? It actually began with Abraham. So he goes all, the genealogy goes all, starts with Abraham and goes all the way to Healy and then Mary and, of course, the Lord Jesus Christ. There's a second Luke in genealogy in Luke chapter 3, and it's in verse 23 says, now Jesus himself began his ministry at about 30 years of age, being, as was supposed, the son of Joseph, the son of Heli. Now let me go back up here in the one in Matthew and read the last verse of the genealogy that Matthew gives. Verse 16, it says, and Jacob, which was Joseph's father, Jacob begot Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. Okay. Did you see a discrepancy there? A contradiction? Any? Matthew up here says, and Jacob begot Joseph, the husband of Mary, who was of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. Jacob begot Joseph. Who was Jacob's father here? Or who was Joseph's father? Jacob. But down here in this genealogy in Luke, it says he was the son of Joseph, the son of Heli, of Heli. That was Mary's father, Heli. So how did that arrange? It goes right back to what we were talking about earlier. The daughter must marry within the tribe. So Mary had to marry Joseph. But what did Joseph have to do in order to make it legal? He was adopted by Heli, Mary's father. Now, the reason for that is this genealogy of line of kings from Solomon stopped at Jehoiachin because of his evil. But hit the that scarlet thread of redemption continued on to Joseph. So how did Joseph pass that genealogy then on to so that Jesus, I'll just say it, he was adopted by Heli, which gave Jesus the right legally to be king of the Jews. And up at King David up there, David had a second son. Remember what his name was? Nathan. That genealogical line followed all the way down to Eli and then to Mary. And his birth to Mary, the firstborn, Jesus had the right of the firstborn to be king of the Jews. He had the legal right through Joseph, through his adoption by Heli. He had the legal right of the birthright to be king of the Jews through Mary. That floored me. You're all sitting there quietly, nobody shaking their head. Does that make sense to you? The detail that God went through. When did it start? When did they come out of Egypt? I'll put it that way. 1,500 years before the Lord was born. God is already planning back there. When did God first know you? Before the foundations of the earth were laid, I knew you. That's what God says to you. He knew you. He knew what you were going to be. He knew you would be sitting here this day. You have a divine appointment to be here this day so I can tell you what little I do know. And it thrills me that God has gone to such detail to bring about our salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ. Isn't that amazing? Huh?
Hallelujah.
Yeah. We have a God that has taken every... You all talk about walking a rough road, going a hard way. If it weren't for God, your road would be a lot harder. He has loved you with a passion that is unexemplified in any Hallmark movie. I'll put it that way. There's another thing here I want to clip through right quick. And I remember the story my dad told a long time ago about the young pastor who got up in front of the church and he said, "This is my first time to preach, and I forgot to ask, how long can I preach?" And the deacon stood up and he said, "You can preach as long as you want to, Pastor." And he said, "Oh, great. But at noon, we're leaving. So you've got 15 minutes. I promise I'll get done because I don't want to see a stampede." Okay. This concerns the process of the adoption. Just read some of the things here. The legal process whereby a person assumed parental responsibility for another person's child, as Mordecai did for Esther. And remember, Moses was put in that little basket, set afloat. Pharaoh's daughter saw it, and young girl on the beach just happened to catch her attention, and she went and got it. And Moses was adopted by that daughter of Pharaoh's, and he was raised as an Egyptian. He knew all the things that Egyptians did and said. And when he went from there out into the wilderness, he had 40 years for God to scour all that out of him. The Code of Hammurabi illustrates adoption law. The Bible contains no law showing the process, rights, or responsibilities involved in adoption. You just adopt them. I have several adopted children in this area. Jeremiah and Marika are two of them. Daniel, who built our house out there, he's one of my sons. And right now my mind's blank. This girl is my daughter too. if you go into, never mind. But there's Old Testament examples of those adoptions. Moses, of course, I just mentioned her, and Esther. Esther was a cousin of Mordecai. Mordecai adopted her as his daughter, I guess you might say, and looked after her. They took place in foreign cultures and reflect those settings more than the Hebrew practice. Some Old Testament traditions approach the idea that Israel's relationship with God was that of an adopted child. And I see it here in Exodus chapter 4, verse 22. It says, "You shall tell Pharaoh," this is Moses going before Pharaoh, "thus says the Lord, Israel is my son, my firstborn." What does that say? God has a special relationship with Israel, the children of Israel. Okay, and then of course there's Esther. Though the idea was never stated explicitly. Okay, New Testament. The New Testament frequently speaks of believers as God's children, and there's several listings here. In Galatians 3:26, for example, it says, "For you are all sons of God through faith in Jesus Christ." John 1:9, I believe, "For as many as receive him, to them gave he power to become sons of God." Children of God is more is better interpretation. Okay. Thus, believers are affirmed in a special and intimate relationship with God. How many religious people do we have here today? Don't raise your hand. Religion is you, us, people, reaching up and bringing God down to our level, serving us. We have a relationship with a loving God who has given us so much. Eternal life. Well, we have eternity to thank him for that. At the same time, the New Testament emphasizes Jesus' unique relationship to God as the only begotten Son. He called God his Abba. In this relationship, in the scripture it says, and he said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for you." In light of this truth, the relationship of believers to God is clearly derivative and secondary. Thus, adoption provides a means of describing the believer's relationship with God while maintaining the uniqueness of Jesus the Son. That's cool. Paul is the only New Testament writer to employ the word adoption. We are adopted into the family of God. He used the term to describe the status persons receive from God when they have been redeemed by God. Okay, I just lost my place. Let me just start reading again then. In light of this truth, Paul is the only New Testament writer to employ the word adoption. You must have to hear it again. That's the way I'm doing this. He used the term to describe the status persons receive from God when they have been redeemed by Jesus Christ. In belonging to Christ, believers become Abraham's offspring and heirs with him of God's promise, his promise to us. Believers are chosen in Christ and predestined to this adoption by God's gracious will. Adoption symbolizes for Paul God's love and grace in accepting believers as his children, intimate members of his family. Adoption occurs through the work of God's Spirit, giving believers power to overcome fleshly temptations and live the life in the Spirit. Okay, you have the power through the Lord Jesus Christ to resist the devil, to resist temptation. God gave it to you there. Lord Jesus Christ gave it to you there on the cross. When he gave his death gave you victory over sin, his resurrection gave you victory over death. You are alive forevermore. This drives out the fears sinners experience in the presence of the holy God, hopefully. It should, it's supposed to. And provides power to pray trustingly to God as our Abba Father, or it says in the term that one of these children would use, as our daddy. Very intimate relationship and term. This drives out the fear sinners experience in the presence of the holy God and provides power to pray trustingly to God. I just read that again. The Spirit living in the believer gives confident assurance that one is accepted fully as a child into God's family. You have that assurance. You are adopted. The believer gives confident assurance that one is accepted, adopted into as a fully as a child into God's family. This means the believer has all the rights of inheritance and will join Jesus, the only begotten Son. Okay, in inheriting the glory of eternal life with God, but it does not mean the believer can escape the suffering, the persecution, the world issues, and persecution that the world issues out to God's people. Just about done. The adoption process will be finalized when God restores all creation, giving his children resurrection bodies. You know what the world is going to be like during the millennial kingdom? Like it was in the Garden of Eden. The curse will be lifted. In other words, how many of you live in the Northwest and know about the Himalaya berries? They are mean. They're alive. They take over. But they won't be any thorns. They won't be any thistles. The lion will lie down with the lamb. The bear will eat straw with the leopard or whatever it was. It will be wonderful. Okay. Adoption has always been God's way of operating with his people. For only spiritual birth, not natural birth, has determined who belong to the covenant people. You are born in the Spirit. You have been reborn, born again into the family of God. You have that assurance. Even Jews under God's law had to be redeemed by God's Son to be adopted sons. Okay, God's children are revealed in their being led by the Spirit and in putting putting to death the deeds of the body. You have to put to death the deeds of the body. You have to put them away. You have to say to them, I rebuke you. Get away from me. It works. Paul recognized here an unfinished quality in the experience, for believers struggle in their weaknesses and groan for freedom from the slavery of sin. Isn't it going to be great? It's going to be. Their adoption is based on hope and can only be finalized in the redemption of the body. Until that time, believers are in the process of being conformed to the image of the Son with the help of the Spirit and with the assurance of their glorification. We have that insurance. We have the assurance that we are children of God. Adoption did not surprise God or his people. Adoption in Christ is the way God chose to create his family even before he created the world. Again, he knew you before the foundations of the earth were laid. He knew you'd be here today. You are here by design appointment. I think I said that earlier. Adoption distinguishes the sonship of believers from the sonship of Christ. Christ is the only Son of God by nature, being part of the divine Trinity. To apply adoption to Christ is heresy. Believers have no natural right to claim to be God's children. Physical birth never has and never will guarantee membership in God's family. Only God's election and grace. Who called upon the other first? Did you call upon God to save you? God first called you, come to me, and then you answered that call. That's the only way it can be. It's the only way it is. Christ, only God's election in grace. Christ's work in redemption and the Spirit's work in the life of the believer bring adoption and make one a child of God. You got a pretty high calling. You know what? I was corrected one day. I used to think it was the fourth of the Ten Commandments. Do you know what the third commandment is? Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. What does that mean? Does that mean you can't say his name as a cuss word, an exclamation, or a swear word? Yeah, it means that. Yep. But it means something far more important. It means it goes to your ambassadorship. The way people see you out in public, out in the grocery store, on the highway. I just thought of a story. I got 2 minutes. This cop pulled his car over for speeding, and he got him over. He was speeding way fast, and he pulled him over, and he walked up the window. "What's the matter, officer?" And he said, "Well, evidently this is a stolen car. The way you were going so fast. This is a stolen car, and also because you were breaking the law, I saw this fish on the back of your car, and I figured that you weren't the owner, and you were stealing this car." He was not acting like a Christian. He saw that fish. "I'm a Christian," is what that fish said. What did his actions say? No. Didn't back him up one bit. So it goes to our ambassadorship. I was going to say one more thing. Will you pay a little overtime? I got a thing here. Yeah, how many of you can prove that there is a triune Godhead through Scripture? You know what I mean by triune Godhead? The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. How many? It doesn't say Trinity in the Scripture anywhere. If I can find it here. Oh, well. Okay, that's in there. That's one way. Is there another way? How about in the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ? I'm going to have to go to the Scripture because I can't find it in my paper. If you go to Matthew, no, somebody's going to have to help me on this. It's in Matthew. No, it's in Luke. No, it's in Acts. No, it's not. This always goes on in my head. Yeah, Nancy will back me up on that one. Here it is. Okay, it's in first chapter of Luke. And if you have your Bibles, turn there and mark it, because this is cool. And this you can point to this for somebody and say, this proves that there is a triune Godhead, that there is a Holy Trinity. And it started out reading in verse 31. It says, "And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of God of the Most Highest, of the Highest, and the Lord of God. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Then Mary said, Mary was old enough, she was a young girl, and yet she knew what made babies. Then Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I do not know a man?" Did I say it wrong or too much? Okay. And verse 35 is where it is. It's, "And the angel answered her and said to her," now listen to this careful, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will come upon, will overshadow you. Therefore also, that Holy One who is to be born will call the Son of God." All three are right there. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit are all there in those scriptures. You can prove. Anything God says, you can prove it through here. And all scripture has to be backed up by two other scriptures. Did you know that? That's another way to prove the Bible. That's all I have to say. I'm going to hand you out a sheet to grade me on this so I can take it to Jeremiah. So maybe I better not. I'm going to pray again for Jeremiah right now. Not yet. I'm trying to act like I'm in charge. Father in heaven, we do thank you for your mighty love. What a wonderful God and Savior you are, Father. We thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ. We celebrated the communion service. Lord, I just thank you for his sacrifice which he has made for each and every one of us to deliver us from the power of sin and to grant and to usher us into your kingdom, kingdom of heaven. Father, thank you so much for that great and wonderful gift of salvation. Mighty grace, Father, we thank you for that. In Jesus' name we would pray it. Amen. Oh yeah, offering. See, I told you somebody's got to keep me in track. We have the ushers up, please. Now, usually about this time, Jeremiah gives a long, drawn out. This is your church. You know, I told someone a long time ago that nothing in the New Testament says how much you should give. Except that it does say what the Spirit puts on you, that is what you should give. It's up to your relationship with God. Father in heaven, we thank you for this time that we can return to you a portion of that which you have entrusted with us. All things belong to you, God, even our income, Lord. And we just pray that you would accept what we give today as our gift to you. We give it with open heart, with loving heart. Father, we just pray that you would bless it, use it to further your gospel. In Jesus' name we would ask it. Amen.
I'd rather be in a deep, dark grave and know that my poor soul was saved, than to live in this world in a house of gold and deny my God and doom my soul. People steal, they cheat and lie for gold and what it will buy. But don't they know that on the judgment day that gold and silver will melt away? For what good is gold and silver too, if your heart's not good and true? So sinner, hear me, hey, when I pray, get down upon your knees and pray. I'd rather be in a deep, dark grave and know that my poor soul was saved, than to live in this world in a house of gold and deny my God and doom my soul. And deny my God and doom my soul.
Thank you. Would you stand with us, please, singing Send the Light? Yeah, we need the light.
There's a call comes ringing for the restless wave. Send the light. Send the light, for there are souls rescue, there are souls to save. Send the light, send the light, send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore. Let us pray that grace be everywhere about. Send the light, light, and the glorious spirit everywhere about. Send the light.
Yep, I am.
You're up.
You're ambassadors to God. You have a purpose. God has given it to you. Go out and exercise that purpose to the glory of God. God bless you. Thank you.